Billy Phipps has a voice that you will never forget. And for decades now, he has used that deep, resonant voice to comfort, inspire, educate, and infuse this world with eternal hope.
Then sings my soul.
From dignitaries to superstars, he has served as a guide and encourager to many of the world's most influential people.
He's got everybody here.
In the history of gospel music, he is one in a million. You are about to experience a never-before-seen glimpse into the heart and soul of Wintley Phipps.
Amen, glory, hallelujah.
Featuring a rare collection of classic hymns, spirituals, gospel classics, and personal stories from his life.
In every story, God gets the glory.
May his story and songs serve as a fresh reminder of the unlimited possibilities in store for anyone who is willing to fully embrace their divine destiny. Gaither Music is pleased to present Wintley Phipps, Amazing Grace.
Would you be free from your passion and pride? This power in the blood. Power in the blood, come for a cleansing to Calvary's tide. There's wonderful power in the blood. Yes, there's power, power, Lord, wonder working power in the blood, in the blood of the Lamb. Oh, yes, there's power, power, Lord, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Would you do service for Jesus your King? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you live daily his praises to sing? There's wonderful power in the blood. Yes, there's power, power, Lord, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. Oh, yes, there's power, power, Lord, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. Yes, there's power, Lord, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. Oh, yes, there's power, power, Lord, wonder-working power in the precious blood of the Lamb. In the precious blood of the Lamb. In the precious blood.
It's a joy to have you here in our little town. I often say to folks, if you come to Alexandria, Indiana, you have come on purpose.
Yeah.
But it's good to have you here.
Good to be with you, my friend.
You've been here before, haven't you?
Oh, yes. Yeah. Yes, I recorded here, and I just love being with you, Bill. It's a joy.
How far does our relationship go back maybe 20, 30?
Oh, yeah.
30 years.
From back in the days of Indiana, Indianapolis, I'm sorry, where we did the big...
The praise gathering.
The praise gatherings in Indianapolis. It goes back a long time.
Yeah. You know, you are part of a special fraternity of a young man who obviously loved music. For all of us who grew up and music got our attention.
Yes.
And in some cases, even got our attention as far as the message of Jesus is concerned.
Yes.
we so loved the art form and the music, and we said, hey, wait, what are they singing about, you know?
Right.
They're singing about Jesus.
Yes.
But you are part of this fraternity that may have started out in music, but you wanted to pursue something else.
Sure.
And anybody who's been around you, Wentley, knows that you love life, you love education, you love learning, you love teaching.
Yes.
And it didn't take you long to say, I can do a certain thing through music,
right?
But I can do a lot more on a given occasion with the spoken word.
Absolutely.
Is that true?
Absolutely correct. I'm going to take you back just a little bit. When I was about 14 and a half years old, my voice changed. I woke up one morning with this sound coming out of my throat. It messed up my father, if you can imagine your 14-year-old kid saying, hey, Dad, how you doing? You
know.
Now, this is in the 60s, so... I wanted to be another Sly Stone. You probably have no idea who that is.
Oh, yes. It was Sly Stone and...
Sly and the Family Stone.
Sly and the Family Stone.
Right. But I met Sly, and he was stoned. And I said, no, something's wrong with this picture. My hero is incoherent, you know. That's not where I want to end up. And I found another musical hero at the time, because I didn't have any voice teachers. But, Bill, I found my voice teacher on the radio. So I'm 15 years old with this voice, and I'm listening, close the door, get a pencil, and I'm practicing sounding like this voice coming over the radio. So for my 34th wedding anniversary, I said to my wife, my voice teacher on the radio, I wonder if he's still in concert. So I Googled, and lo and behold, he was in concert. So I bought plane tickets and concert tickets. Something told me, send him a message. So I sent him an email. I said, sir, when I was 15, my voice changed. I didn't have any voice teachers, but you became my voice teacher on the radio. That's how I learned to sing. You have been my musical inspiration, my musical North Star. And then I said, I want to tell you all I've gone on to do with that inspiration. And I shared with him how, at the time, I'd sung for 6 presidents of the United States, and I was the only soloist at Diana Ross's wedding in Switzerland, and the last one to sing Amazing Grace for Mother Teresa before she died, you know. I said, I may not get to see you, but I want to thank you. I got an email back from him saying, Sir Tom Jones would like to see you and your wife when you come to Las Vegas.
So the guy was Tom Jones.
That's how I learned to sing. So when I walked into the green room, his eyes went really big because I said, it's not unusual to be loved by anyone. So that was my first foray into using this voice. And of course, I heard other voices like Paul Robeson and, you know, great bass baritone singers, William Warfield, who sang Old Man River, you know. I said, wow, that's what you could do with this, you know. And then I went to a Christian school for my last year of high school in Oshawa, Canada. That's where I grew up. I grew up in Montreal, Canada. And that's outside of Toronto.
Okay, yeah.
And I didn't like it at first because they had too many rules and regulations for me, you know. All the lights got turned out at a certain hour. You couldn't hold hands with the girls on campus and, you know, stuff like that. And I went to the dean of men and I said, I can't take all these rules. I said, I'm leaving. He said, is that what you really want to do? I said, yeah. He said, why don't you do for once? Not what you want to do, but what God wants you to do. And that's when I went up to my room. For the first time in my life, I prayed that I remember praying. And I said, God, whatever you want me to do, I'll do. I said, if you want me to be a garbage man, for you, I'm willing to be a garbage man. If the only music I'll know is whistling hymns on the back of a garbage truck, that's fine. And then I said, God, you know, I'd like to travel and use my talents for you. if that's your will for me, open the doors. Let me see in some way. A day went by, a couple of men came up to me and said, are you Wintley Phipps? I said, yeah. He said, we've been hearing about you. We want you to travel and do singing evangelism with us. They said, we're from a group called the Heritage Singers and Heritage Family. And I said, wow.
Well, they sang a bunch of Gaither songs.
Oh, right? Yes, they did.
What was his name? Max?
Max Mace.
Max, yeah, what Max a good Mace. Man.
And then, so I tell people when you get your first prayer answered, it scars you for life because it lets you know there is a God and he is real and he hears and answers prayer. And as I walked the campus of that school, recognizing that there is a God and I'm in deep conviction, I'm listening now. And Bill, I heard a voice that I now know as God speak to my heart saying, I've seen your dreams. Now give me your dreams. And I'll let you glimpse a little of what I've been dreaming for you.
All to Jesus I surrender. All to him I freely give. I will ever love and trust him. In his presence daily live. I surrender all. I surrender all. All to thee, my blessed Savior, I surrender all. All to Jesus I surrender, humbly at his feet I bow. Worldly pleasures now forsaken, take me, Jesus, take me now. I surrender.
I share with young artists. I tell them all those amazing experiences, those are moments of destiny. And I say, moments of destiny are moments for which you were created, but they're not the reason for which you were created. The reason for which you were created is to grow more every day, to resemble, reflect, and reveal the character of God in your life.
And when I think of God, His Son, not sparing, gave Him to die, I scarce can take it in that on the cross my burden gladly bearing He bled and died to take away my sin. Acclamation to take me home. What joy shall fill my heart, and I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great.
I've sung for Democrats, Independents, Republicans. As a matter of fact, I'll tell you one funny thing. One day I had to sing at a big function in Washington where President Clinton spoke. You know, I've sung for President Reagan, President Bush, you know, seven of the last eight presidents. So I'm singing at this function where President Clinton spoke. And the same night, I had to rush across town and sing at this big Republican function. And when I got there, I announced that I had just come from singing for the President of the United States. And there was this boo and rumbling that went through the audience. I said, wait a minute. I said, I always go where people really need the Lord. And there was this polite applause. And then I said, and that's why I'm here. You know?
So you have had a lot of opportunities to speak to believers, non-believers.
I've been blessed to reach some of the most amazing people. One day I was singing in Baltimore, Maryland, and I came down off the platform and I felt a tap on my shoulder. The young lady said, excuse me, sir, I just heard you sing. I'm really discouraged. She was about to be fired, really. She was making $25,000 a year on her job. She said, I feel like I can talk to you. Do you have time to talk to me? I said, sure. So she came by our home. We talked and prayed together. And after praying with her, I said, you know, before you go, God has impressed me to tell you He's going to bless you and give you an opportunity to speak to millions of people. She sat up. She said, you think God would do that for me? And it was Oprah Winfrey. And that's how we met. all those years ago. And God has had me ministering to people of all political, all stripes, because we all need the Lord. And whatever we can do to help make our nation a nation of Christians is the most important thing we can do to help America. Listen to my story. It's the story about my Jesus. Amen. Amen. Hey, see the little baby. Amen. Wrapped up in a manger on Christmas morning. Amen. Amen. Hey, see him by the seashore, talking to the fishermen, and he's making them disciples. Amen. Amen. Hey, riding through Jerusalem. Palm branches in all pomp and splendor. Amen. 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 See him in the garden praying to his Father in deepest sorrow. Amen. 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 Led before Pilate, then they crucified him, but he rose on Easter. And by the way, I tell you, I have a little secret personal dream that I carry in my heart, Bill. That one day I'll be in heaven. I dream about it. Working on my mansion with my holy hammer, right? Like if there'll be something broke that needs to be fixed, right? And I'll hear a knock on the door. And when I open it, Jesus will be standing there. Yeah. Clothed in light, crown of glory on his head, and he'll say to me, "My son, I'm about to go to some parts of my universe where they've never seen a child from earth who has been redeemed, and I want you to come go with me. Oh, and by the way, I want you to sing just before I speak." that's the dream I carry in my heart, Bill. And can you imagine the Lord saying, "Okay, I want you to sing for the angels, or sing for this group. What song would you sing? Yeah. And that's why some of those great...
I hope it would be a Gaither tune. that just flipped into my mind.
He's got the whole world in his hands. 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 He's got the wind and the rain in his hands. He's got the wind and the rain in his hands. He's got the wind and the rain in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got the little bitty baby in his hands. He's got the little bitty baby in his hands. He's got the little bitty baby in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got you and me, brother, in his hands. He's got you and me, sister, in his hands. He's got you and me, brother, in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got everybody here in his hands. He's got everybody here in his hands. He's got everybody here in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands.
I both have a wonderful connection with the Graham organization.
Yes.
And the one that we did at the Graham Center there in Montreat.
Right.
In front of a beautiful fireplace.
That's right.
And we had a chance to pick from the great literature that has come from the Black history.
Yes.
What a unique approach James Weldon Johnson did on how the world was made.
That's right.
Yeah.
And it's full of what in the Black church we call sermonic license. You know, it's using your imagination and your creativity to imagine what it must have been like when God scooped out of the earth a lump of clay and breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and man became a living soul.
I love it. I love it. Listen to it.
And God stepped out on space. And he looked around and said, I'm lonely. I'll make me a world. And as far as the eye of God could see, darkness covered everything. Blacker than 100 midnights, down in a cypress swamp. Then God smiled, and the light broke, and the darkness rolled up on one side, and the light stood shining on the other, and God said, that's good. Then God reached out and took the light in his hands, and God rolled the light around in his hands until he made the sun. And he set that sun ablazing in the heavens. And the light that was left from making the sun, God gathered it up in a shining ball and flung it against the darkness, spangling the night with the moon and stars. Then down between the darkness and the light, he hurled the world, and God said, "That's good." And God himself stepped down, and the sun was on his right hand, and the moon was on his left. The stars were clustered about his head, and the earth was under his feet, and God walked, and where he trod, his footsteps hollowed the valleys out and bulged the mountains up. And then he stopped and looked and saw that the earth was hot and barren. So God stepped over to the edge of the world and he spat out the seven seas. He batted his eyes and the lightnings flashed. He clapped his hands and the thunders rolled. And the waters above the earth came down. The cooling waters came down. Then the green grass sprouted and the little red flowers blossomed. The pine tree pointed his finger to the sky and the oak spread out his arms. The lakes cuddled down in the hollows of the ground and the rivers ran down to the sea, and God smiled again. And the rainbow appeared and curled itself around his shoulder. Then God raised his arm and he waved his hand over the sea and over the land. And he said, bring forth, and quicker than God could drop his hand, fishes and fowls and beasts and birds swam. The rivers and the seas roamed the forest and the woods and split the air with their wings. And God said, that's good. Then God walked around and God looked around on all that he had made. He looked at his sun. He looked at his moon. And he looked at his little stars. He looked on his world with all its living things, and God said, I'm lonely still. Then God sat down on the side of a hill where he could think. By a deep, wide river, he sat down with his head in his hands. God thought, I'll make me a man. Up from the bed of the river, God scooped the clay, and by the bank of the river, he kneeled him down, and there the great God Almighty, who lit the sun and fixed it in the sky, who flung the stars to the most far corner of the night, who rounded the earth in the middle of his hand, this great God, like a mammy bending over her baby, kneeled down in the dust, toiling over a lump of clay till he shaped it in his own image. Then into it he blew the breath of life. And man became a living soul. Amen. Amen.
In our ministry, we focus on character building and through mentoring. And again, when a child is learning to read and a child is learning academics, that's an exercise in character building. When a child recognizes that there's so much I've got to learn, and I'm willing to embrace learning. Character is everything.
Let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with me. Let there be peace on earth, the peace that was meant to be. With God as our Father, brothers all are we. in perfect harmony. Let peace begin with me. Let this be the moment now. With every step I take, let this be my solemn vow, to take each moment and live each moment in peace eternally. Let there be peace on earth, and let it God as our Father, brothers all are we. Let me walk with my brother in perfect harmony. Let this be the moment now. With every step I take, let this be my solemn vow, to take each moment and live each moment in peace eternally. Let there be peace on earth, and let it begin with me.
You know, I almost could have started this interview with one of the most important stories of my life. I was at home, and an aunt came to visit me who I hadn't seen in years. And she was walking around the house looking at all the pictures with all the presidents and you know, Oprah and Mrs. King and Rosa Parks and she sees all these pictures with President Reagan, and she says, sit down, I want to tell you something. So I sat down and she said, your father, my brother, 2 years before you were born, we had a sister named Pearl who died while having an abortion, getting rid of an unwanted pregnancy. And when your mother became pregnant with you outside of wedlock, there were some who were urging her to do the same. But we, some of us gathered, rallied around your mother to say, no, we went through too much pain losing our sister. We don't want anything like this to happen again. And then your mother's mother came up and paid a visit to our mother, your father's mother, and they closed the door to talk about this situation. And they made a pact that they would pray for the life of this child. And they decided the prayer that they were going to pray is, Lord, make this child's life a blessing to the world. And so, Bill, all that's happened in my life, all the places that I've gone, all the audiences that I've sung to, meeting you, working with you, you have been a blessing to my ministry in ways that I cannot begin to count. And I could never find the words to express to you and Gloria my gratitude, my love. You opened doors for me. But what I want you to see is that what you did and what God has done in my life and ministry.
Okay.
It's an answer to two grandmothers' prayers.
that's a wonderful story. That's a wonderful story.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see.
Wintley, one of these days, life as we know it here on earth is going to be over for both of us.
That's correct.
And some folks are going to say something about you.
Yeah.
What would you like for them to say?
I would like for them to say that here was a child who really loves Jesus. one of the songs that I'm singing, and I've been enjoying singing it, is an old Negro spiritual. Talk about a child that do love Jesus.
Here's one.
Here's one. I would love for them to be able to say, there's one child who loved Jesus so much that he dedicated his life completely to Christ. He tried his best to resemble, reflect, and reveal the character of Christ in his life. And he tried to inspire and motivate as many people as possible to become more like the character of Christ. If I could have that said about me, that's all I need.
Ever since I heard the gospel story, I've been traveling up the path to glory. Talk about a child that do love Jesus. Here's one. Here's one. Ever since I heard the gospel